Here's the question that is on everybody's mind. If you kill Frankenstein and replace his arms, does he come back the same monster? What about his legs? What about every single limb, one by one? At what point does that creature become something new? It's got to be the head, right? And yet, what if the person who the limbs came from hated the person who the head came from? Could they just reject it like an organ? Lebanon is a land of resurrection. It's the home of the phoenix. But by the early 7th century, it had died and been reborn a dozen times over, and nothing ever comes back the same. They would be given new trade networks, new emperors, new languages, and gods, new heads on this aging corpse of limbs. So yeah, Lebanon is a land of resurrection, but it is also a Frankenstein. And just because you sew on some new head doesn't mean that the body's just going to accept it.
High in the mountains, perched above the world, the now isolated Maronites of Lebanon watched as everything they'd ever known slowly collapsed below them. They'd once called themselves Romans, but what did that even mean anymore? Rome was gone. And the moment their bastard sons in Constantinople got the chance, they'd sent an army of more subservient Christians to come and murder and replace them. Cut off a limb, stick on a new one. And with the country around them barely 5% Muslim, they weren't in those mountains because of Islam. They were there because of everybody, because of the many changing heads who saw them as an unwieldy limb. To the average person, it might not have mattered who ruled, but it did matter how they ruled. And frankly, for a full 100 years, those incoming Arabs really didn't seem as bad as the Byzantines who'd come before. For the most part, they'd kind of seemed content to leave the Christians of Lebanon alone. Those new heads couldn't quite manage all these limbs going phantom, and so with the old empires getting slaughtered, there was more than enough for everybody to eat. And for a time, things were good. They were calm. But it quickly became clear that the corrupting influence within that conquering Islamic empire wasn't going to be Islam, but empire. And in politics, just as in religion, you cannot stop the schisms. So let's jump back to Arabia in 632 AD. The Prophet Muhammad is dead. The great empire of the Muslims has not yet truly begun, but as of this moment, it has already started to collapse. Because with Islam having twinned its politics to religion, crises of succession weren't just problems of man, but of faith. And politics are anything but holy. Even with the best of intentions, every decision you ever make is going to deal somebody a bad hand. And then what? You just cut it off? And so before their prophet is even buried, it is haunting the air. Who's the new head? Who's going to pick up that halo and wear it like a crown? And over the next what has been now 1,400 years since, millions upon millions of people would die over this one decision. It's the first great schism of Islam. Politics, baby. The first caliph of the Rashidun would be Abu Bakr, which was much to the surprise of Muhammad's cousin and son-in-law, Ali, a man many had presumed to be the heir. To see him undercut would have been a huge political slight. For Bakr to take power was no small thing. The fact that he was nominated to power by what would become the second caliph was also not a small thing. One of the first statements that Abu Bakr would make after the death of Muhammad is that the prophet was nothing more than a man and that his followers should praise and pray to God instead, which is both theologically true within Islam, but also a statement of imperial politics. It isn't hard to see that there's a not-so-subtle meaning behind it, that bloodline doesn't matter, and therefore Ali doesn't have the claim he might think he does. To remove Ali is to remove the idea that Islam is a dynasty, that name matters more than piety. And of course, there were already those who felt otherwise. Ali had a holy bloodline. He came from the original converts. For many, that meant he should rule. And from a purely political standpoint, therefore for Abu Bakr, that meant that he was the sort of man you did not want to keep around. Simply put, he was a thorn, a threat. Perhaps the only person who could genuinely accuse the caliphs of not following the Prophet's words and survive it, which he did quite often, in fact. Despite everybody else falling in line, Ali would hold out for a full 6 months before giving Bakr his blessing as caliph, and even then, only when the situation was undeniable. And yet, after that point, regardless of who took charge, from that moment on, he always made sure that the caliphs felt the weight of his disapproval. However, in the early years, when that empire was still expanding, it was a lot easier to overlook these fractured politics of home. With wealth constantly flowing through the gates of Mecca, there was more than enough to go around to keep people pacified. But 12 years after the death of Muhammad, and that empire would already be on its third caliph. The assassination of the second Umar would spell the beginning of the end for those Rashidun, although it would have likely been impossible to see that at that time. The third caliph would be handed a dilemma that most rulers, I believe, wish to be handed. He took over on the verge of conquering Persia. He just sort of had to sit back and watch it happen. And there, his armies would encounter more wealth than any of them could have possibly imagined. Gold, silver, jewels, you name it. More plunder than the deserts of Arabia would have ever experienced before. And with that extreme wealth came extreme temptation. People who'd started their lives drinking goat milk in a tent were now facing the greatest luxuries that their world had to offer, and that is a very hard thing to say no to. That said, for his part, the third caliph, Uthman, would perform his Arabian duty. He would melt those treasures down and hand them out to the people of Mecca. He himself would hoard nothing. Or at least so they say. But even within honesty, jealousy can breed lies, and the craziest thing about giving away billions is how many enemies you can make doing it. Uthman would even die for it. Historically, they'd frame his assassination as a response to nepotism. In Syria, the family Umayyad had gained great wealth under Uthman, and in their unchecked power had sort of begun defying the norms of Meccan austerity, not necessarily Islam, but at the very least the social understanding of what Islam was supposed to be. And for many, that made this outright blasphemy. And it certainly didn't reflect well that they happened to be from Uthman's clan. So those who murdered that caliph would leave his body unburied, call him a heretic, and then see him tossed in a Jewish grave without Islamic funeral rites. The reasons for that might be many, but it's really hard not to notice that it all seems to start around the time that they got that Persian money. However, that said, regardless of why, rising from the horror of that assassination came the fourth caliph, Ali. It wasn't as if the revolution was meant to put him in power specifically, it was just sort of a process of elimination. He was the natural lightning rod for those who wanted change. Who else could speak up like he did? Who else had the pedigree to rule? God clearly favored him. So in June 656, 24 years after it was supposedly taken from him, Ali became the head of that caliphate. And he'd immediately set about making it his own. It's just, this wasn't a head that the body would accept. Times had changed. Austerity might have been the way of the Meccans, but it did not rule the world, and it certainly didn't rule in Damascus. In Syria, that family Umayyad would react to Uthman's assassination as nothing less than a declaration of war. And from their stronghold in the north, they'd spent the last few years amassing enough wealth to raise an army nearly 150,000 strong. The battle that would be fought between those two heads would be nothing less than the battle for the soul of Islam, and quite tellingly to the future that it would create. It's a battle that nobody won. Although, that said, somehow Ali still lost. In not destroying his enemies, the people his army had considered heretics, Ali had sent a shockwave back through his own supporters. He was posing a question that couldn't be spoken, but needed an answer. Why didn't God favor him? If Ali was more pious than the Umayyad, why didn't he get to crush them? All of the early successes of Islam's armies had been considered miracles from God. I mean, people still firmly believe they were to this day, so why didn't Ali get one? And then, if that was true, God, was the killing of Uthman unjust? All of a sudden, it was a lot harder to say. So when Ali gets assassinated, it doesn't come from the outside. It comes from his own soldiers. Not because they thought his ideas were bad, they just didn't see God in him anymore. The mandate of heaven demands that you win, and so they killed him. There are those today who will never forget this betrayal. They're called the Shia. They were called that then also, but they're still called that. Although that said, you can't stop the schisms, so these days that word covers hundreds of different groups that disagree on virtually everything. Generally speaking, it's safe to say that Ali being the rightful heir is pretty much the only one thing they do agree on. But now he's dead. And with Ali out of the way, those Umayyad would take his crown. That said, the halo was a bit more complicated. It seemed to get a bit scuffed up in all that civil war. On their rise to power, those Umayyad would murder not only Ali's son, but also Muhammad's grandson. They would destroy the structures of the Rashidun and move its capital to Damascus, and from now on, there would be no more elections. Abu Bakr was wrong. The sons of power should remain in power. There was a holy bloodline. A caliph should be king. The only thing they really disagreed with the Shia on was whose bloodline. And with the Umayyad came a new head. New ideas, new trade networks, and a new empire. But for the most part, here in Lebanon, all the limbs stayed the same. Towards the Christians of this region, those Umayyads would spend their 90 years in power expressing roughly the same indifference that the Rashidun had, only now with the economic benefit of having their capital just next door in Damascus. To keep the peace with the potential Christian threat now on their imperial doorstep, Syria and Lebanon would be given special attention by this new empire, the simple promise of be good and we won't come get those taxes. And so for a time, things were good. But in the 740s, cataclysmic civil wars rocked the Umayyads in ways they couldn't recover from, and the chaos of a new head was mounted onto this empire of schism. They called themselves the Abbasids. Based in Baghdad, with no thought of Syria but that of revenge, these Abbasids would become historically violent, keeping their constantly weakening grip on power purely through the threat of horrific reprisal. In an attempt to project their Islamic values to subjects who didn't trust them, as well as pay back the virtually infinite debts that they'd incurred in their rebellion, those Abbasids would do something that none had ever attempted before. They'd start to squeeze. They'd tax the Christians of Lebanon in ways that they'd never dreamed of trying, years in advance, decades in advance, demanding payments that none could pay, and yet demanding them with some very serious threats. By 752, every single denomination of Christian in Lebanon would revolt together against the new empire. It would be the first time that they would ever unite behind one banner. Not that it did them much good. According to the Maronite sources, the subsequent massacres of those Abbasids would kill nearly a third to half of all people, burning entire villages to the ground with everyone inside. Even those who took no part in the rebellion would pay for it with their lives. But outside these mountains, that squeeze wasn't much different. This new empire was bankrupt, both financially and morally, and they would take that money from anywhere they could find it. So in the lands of Jordan in the 790s, a group of Christians converted to Shia Islam in the hopes of avoiding this increasing violence. They were called the Tanukids, although you might know them by their Greek name Saracens, and they found themselves living between, shall we call it, Iraq and a hard place. As Hellenized Christians, they'd converted to Shia Islam to avoid the violence sweeping through their region, but almost as soon as they'd converted, that violence came sweeping back against them. In this Abbasid empire, nowhere felt safe. And so facing total destruction as a people, in the late 8th century, they would flee to Lebanon, these barely Shia migrants flooding towards that once Christian coast, filling pockets left behind by their newly slaughtered neighbors. And it was there in Lebanon that they would find success that they'd lost in the regions they'd left behind. Although their rulers didn't quite care for the Shia exactly, Baghdad was still quicker to trust these converts than the local people they'd just committed a genocide against, so soon enough they were pronounced the new rulers of the mountains of southern Lebanon. Their power would center around an area called Chouf, extending roughly from Syria to Beirut. The intent of Sunni Baghdad was to deliberately place these ostensibly, shall we say, expendable Muslims in the path of any future Christian rebellion, sort of like shock soldiers of the empire. Which frankly might well have worked if it weren't for our old friend Schism. Because these were not united times, even by the standards of our world. The Abbasids might have taken the crown, but the halo was now forever out of reach. A near endless bloodletting, because now absolutely nobody would be willing to accept the wrong type of believers in charge, and there were too many wrong types of believers, be they religious or political. And he who held the crown held a threat. He who ruled the empire could kill without mercy and justify it with God. And so if you wanted to fight that, it was up to man. It didn't matter what part of the empire you were in, that revolt was everywhere forever. It is hard to imagine that at their core in Baghdad, the Abbasids were simultaneously experiencing the greatest golden age that a caliphate would ever witness, because there's only so much control that violence can bring. If you apply too much, you will find yourself beheaded. And starting on the fringes at the very start and working their way towards that center, every few decades, another province would fall to revolution. Spain peeled off in 756, Morocco in 88, Tunisia in 800, and Egypt in 868. In 869, they'd even experience a revolt of their Bantu slaves. For nearly 15 years, those Africans would form a breakaway state called Zanj. But this is a story about Lebanon, and it would be Egypt's revolution that would most affect them. Claiming heritage from Ali himself, in the 900s, a new Shia caliphate would rise in Cairo. Under the name Fatimids, these warriors of schism would conquer all the way up to the Byzantine border, splintering the remaining Abbasids into pieces from which they would never return. But being the first Shia ruler in a world of Sunni violence came with an unspeakable amount of danger, and in turn, as a means of political necessity, they'd let their people believe far more freely than anyone could in the lands of the Abbasid. After all, almost none of their subjects were Shia. Tolerance was a necessity of survival. And so there, in Egypt, in all that tolerant disorder, a brand new religion would blossom. Multiple, actually, but only one I'm going to talk about today, although it's one few have heard of outside of their victimhood. They call themselves Al-Mawahidun, or the Monotheists, although everyone else rather insultingly calls them the Druze. And the Druze are a complicated people, as I suppose all people are, but unlike most offshoots of monotheism, the Druze are a purely ethnic religion, meaning you can't convert in. According to the Druze, every single one living today is just a reincarnation of a Druze who came before. As they see the world, the only time anyone should have been allowed to join was in the first few years of their religion existing, because according to them, all people on Earth are just reincarnations of people alive at that time, so nobody needs to be offered again. They already had their chance, and they missed it. But that said, not everybody missed it, because here in Lebanon, for whatever reason, those freshly immigrated Tanu kids decided that this new form of monotheism was the light. For reasons that nobody seems to have recorded, that one specific group of people began to convert en masse. They converted in such numbers that soon enough the true heartland of the Druze wasn't in Egypt, but in the mountains of Lebanon, stretching from Syria to the sea. And they would not be alone in that. This was an era of chaos. And in the late 800s, another Shia sect would rise. They're called the Alawites, and they too would be an ethnic religion. But under the violence of the Abbasids, they would be forced from Iraq to the mountains of Syria, where they'd create an insular community that has learned to keep its faith secret from outsiders. So although they're dramatically different in virtually every respect theologically, from the perspective of those who are looking in from the outside, at least in a secular political perspective, these two religions share a lot of similarities. Most specifically, the Druze and Alawite face the same dilemma within the Islamic empires. Because to a liberal, they're just a branch of Shia, but to a more hardline Islamist, they're heathens. And therefore, it's imperative that they be slaughtered like pagans, which provides a balancing act for their interactions with their Muslim rulers, a sort of theological axe that's hanging over their head. Because if they step too far out of line, the imams of the empire will declare them apostates. It's sort of a do what we want or die. That is, if they had the army to do it. Everybody was a bit busy at the moment, as if the Abbasids and Byzantines didn't have enough civil war on their plate. In rode an army from the steppes greater than had existed in centuries. Using Islam like a cause for war, those Seljuks spread across the world like an unstoppable wave, and they had no love for the Christian or the Shia, at least not their rulers. Between 1040 and 1090 AD, they would conquer from China to Oman to the gates of Constantinople. In the Battle of Manzikert in 1071, they'd even slaughter the entire Byzantine army, including its emperor. And although Europe was nowhere near as strong, wealthy, or united as any of the empires of Islam, that loss would send shockwaves all the way to the gates of London. And 20 years later, in 1095, that new emperor of the collapsing Byzantine state would cry out for help from those neighboring Europeans, which would have been a pretty big deal, because he would have changed to orthodoxy in the Great Schism of 1054, and yet would still be sending emissaries to the Catholic Pope asking for mercenaries, kind of like a head begging for some limbs. It was really, truly, a last-ditch effort to push back the Turkish invaders who now threatened the very memory of a once Roman Empire. And for their part, Rome would answer that call, just not specifically to help Constantinople. To that weakened French pope, this must have seemed like a Hail Mary, a chance not just to save Europe from its oncoming civil disaster, but to resurrect Christ under a single banner, to heal the great Christian schism. And so, of course, he sent out that call. That pope would offer salvation to murderers, to adulterers, to blasphemers and thieves. He would spiritually pardon both past and future sins. He'd forgive your debts, protect your lands, and no matter what atrocities you committed, if you went on that crusade, your crimes would be judged in a different court. If you murdered correctly, that pope would claim, Jesus will send you to heaven. It was a simple promise taken up by hundreds of thousands. That said, the Holy Land was a very long way away. Most people couldn't afford that, no matter how religious they were, and so many of those idealistic zealots would just turn towards their heathens at home. Why go all the way to Jerusalem when you could get to heaven without even leaving your city? The church might have said the Jews were off limits, but that's not what some Germans heard. And so despite both emperor and pope disagreeing on paper, nobody really showed up to stop the slaughter. And so as this mass of guilt-ridden monsters slouched their way towards Bethlehem, they dug up the soil behind them like some 6-foot trail to hell. By the second and third waves, things were a bit different. Those pious and insane mobs had given way to a more professional killer. In the minds of these new soldiers, this war, like all wars, was just another path towards wealth and fame. These second and third sons of noblemen, criminals, and minor lords from minor lands would form themselves into semi-professional armies, hoping to conquer the entrepôts of the greatest trade network that their world had ever known. Anatolia, Syria, Lebanon, these were the prizes, the lands of silk and spice, the ports that provided Europe's luxuries. These weren't men going just to praise God. They were going to make money. And for the most part, those soldiers were French. Which, as it turns out, although nobody would have known it at the time, would be a very important thing. As these paladins of Paris conquered their way down the coast, try to imagine the emotions that they felt, just increasing with every step. They began to enter the lands of their Bible on a biblical crusade. When they crossed those Taurus Mountains and entered the plains above Lebanon, they would begin to start to feel a form of spiritual importance in the land around them. Things would feel different than at home, charged, more connected to God. And so imagine with that environment around you, with that emotion surrounding your army, how crazy it would have been for those invaders when just as soon as they'd entered the Holy Land, they found a group of Catholics all but lost to the memory of Rome. Those who would call themselves the Maronites, cut off for hundreds of years and yet somehow still maintaining that allegiance to their God. They were like living propaganda for these crusaders. They were the sea within the sea. And finding these brothers in Christ, those French zealots would naturally begin to treat them as God-given allies, like Sherpas of these mountains of white. They would use those Maronites in their armies, they would support them in their trades, and in turn make them the administration that would help maintain their newly built crusader states. They would bring new languages, new trade networks, new emperors, but most importantly to them, the same God. And in turn, those Maronites would teach these new invaders the most valuable secrets of the Orient. They'd help translate that golden age of Islam and kickstart what was then a relatively backwater Europe. It was through these Lebanese guides that many of the advancements of the Arabs would enter early French and therefore European universities. They'd transfer mathematics, science, philosophy, and astronomy. They'd bring maps and news of the world to the East. And in return, those French would make them feel strong again. Which would not be the case for everybody else. These were true zealots, and zealots rarely have a soul. When those crusaders entered Jerusalem, they would murder or exile virtually every living person. If you weren't a Christian, you didn't deserve to live. And in a system many would recognize from modern-day politics, they would declare any house that had been emptied during the war now up for grabs. Any Christian who lived in a vacant home for a year could claim it as their own. Just don't think about what made it vacant. For the next 170 years, as those French crusaders kept their grip on this coastline, the Maronites would find themselves back on top of the Lebanese pile. No Byzantines to take their autonomy, no caliphate to ignore them. This new French head served them exactly as they'd always wanted. And so even after those crusader states fell, those Maronites would sustain that connection with their new European friend. And almost 1,000 years later, it would be a friendship that would save them from total destruction. But more on that next time. This is Rare Earth.
The good boy of Sidon.